121. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Father, we thank you, O Lord, for your precious word, Lord God, that leads us, guides us, and directs us. Holy Spirit, you have chosen upon this earth, and especially in this, well, really from the beginning of calling your people Israel, from the time frame that you called Abraham, Lord God, you've always had a remnant in the land, and certainly in the church age, Lord, you have chosen to use marred clay, Lord. You formed Adam from the clay of this earth, oh Lord God. It was before the fall, and you molded him, and you breathed your life into him. But since the fall, Lord, mankind, born of clay, born of this earth, has been marred. Jeremiah the prophet said, you told Jeremiah the prophet to go to the potter's house. And when he showed up over there in the vision, what he saw was marred clay upon the potter's wheel. Lord, you're the potter and you're forming the clay, oh Lord God. But it's marred. It's all twisted off. It's thrown off. Nevertheless, you've chosen to use marred clay, Lord, as a vessel through which you would speak. And I know why you've done it, Lord. It's because you want the glory, Lord God. You don't want people looking at some prized possession, some beautiful vessel as though it had anything to do with what it is that you're doing. But instead, Lord, it is your word, and you've chose the foolishness of preaching to confound the wise. And so we pray this morning that you would preach, Lord. We pray that you would show up, Holy Spirit, because you're the preacher, Lord God. You are alone are the teacher that we need to hear. And I pray this morning that you would use this clay vessel, Lord God, and that you would fill my mouth with your words, oh Lord. The word of the living God, not the word of a man. I pray, Lord God, that all the things that I've written and all the things that I've read, if they're out of your will, Lord God, that they would fall to the wayside, Lord, and that instead you would speak this morning, Lord, that you'd speak to your people and that you would anoint the word of God, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, and that it be driven deep down inside of their hearts, Lord God, because there's people in this place this morning, Lord, people that may even watch on the video, Lord God, that are on a journey, Lord, they're on a pilgrimage, and sometimes they find themselves in the midst of a valley. And they don't know, Lord, where else to turn or where else to look, Lord. I pray that you'd cause their eyes to look upward, Lord, upward towards their help, because their help has to come from you, oh Lord God. And I pray that you'd make it real to them this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. And that's really what the psalm that we're talking about this morning is. There's about 15 of them, and they're known as the Pilgrim Psalms. Pilgrim Psalms, you know, and you know, I don't know if you're familiar with the terminology of a pilgrim. There was actually a book that was written in the 1800s called Pilgrim's Progress. It was written by a man named John Bunyan. I read the book last year, I believe it was. I loved the book. It was an allegory on the Christian journey. And Pilgrim, I think that was what his name was the main character of the story, and he was traveling and he was coming across various trials and tribulations along the way. And really, if you read the Bible from front to finish, what you're going to find is a common scenario that takes place time and again, that God's people on this journey of life find themselves encountering these types of circumstances, find themselves facing situations that cause pain, that cause heartache, that cause sorrowfulness. And in reality, this psalm is one of those pilgrim psalms. And what you can see is that he's on a journey. And what it says is this, is that he says in verse 1, he says, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. Now, before we really get into hills and what the concept is there, I just want to give you a basic idea of the fact and remind you of the geography and the topography of the nation of Israel. I draw too many maps, and you've seen them before, but let me just go ahead and draw you a quick map that the nation of Israel, all this right here would be the Mediterranean Sea, okay? So this is their western border, and up here is the Sea of Galilee, and then there was the Jordan River and the Dead Sea. And so this area between the river and between this western border is known as that strip of land called Israel. Now, what I need you to understand also is that there were mountains that this is a valley. This is the Jordan Valley right here where the river is. And not only that, all of this region is very mountainous. And in this area here is where Jerusalem is located. And it was a city that sat upon a hill. The elevation of Jerusalem is about 2,500 feet. And if you've ever been in the mountains, 2,500 feet is pretty significant as far as a mountain. I mean, I've been on higher and higher elevations before, but it's a pretty significant elevation. But the idea here is this, is that number one, this person's on a journey, and we'll talk a little bit about more about that, but whenever you're in the midst of a valley, so the point that I'm trying to make with all of this is to let you know that there were full of mountains and it was full of valleys. And when you're on a journey like this in the physical sense, that you can be oftentimes in a valley in a physical sense, and when you're in a valley, there's really nowhere else to look but up, amen? And spiritually speaking, when you're in the midst of a spiritual valley, there's really what you need to get in your head. And what I need to get in my head is there's really nowhere else but to look up, amen? And whenever the psalmist was writing, what he was talking about is many times they would go on a journey, the children of Israel, three times a year, according to Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 16. As a matter of fact, why don't we turn some pages this morning, and let's just go ahead and turn there just so that we can familiarize ourselves with places where the Bible are. So you want to turn to the left. And Deuteronomy chapter 16, and I'm going to read the passage of Scripture to you. Well, it looks like I put the wrong Scripture. No, I didn't. Deuteronomy 16, 16. Three times in a year shall all your males appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose, in the feast of unleavened bread, and in the feast of weeks, and in the feast of tabernacles, and they shall not appear before the Lord empty. So they're saying that the males have to appear, but in reality, the whole family would often journey. And what's happening is that the male that represents the family as the head of the household is the one that would present himself before the Lord. And he was not to show up empty-handed, meaning he was to show up with a sacrifice to offer unto God. Now, what these festivals were in reference to in the Old Testament, these feasts or festivals, and we've taught on them before, but if you've never familiarized yourself with it, then you may not understand. But the first one, unleavened bread, was a week-long festival or feast that started with the Passover. The Passover, many of you know, is the night that God delivered Israel out of Egyptian bondage. On the Passover night, God told his children Israel to take a lamb. See, the Word of God teaches, if you read it from the beginning to the end, that God has a plan. It's one plan. He's never changed the plan. And ultimately, the plan was that he was going to give his son to die on the cross, to shed his blood, and to pay the penalty so that you and I, who were far away from God, could be restored back to God, if that makes sense. But even thousands of years before that ever happened, God was already writing or painting the picture for us through these people called Israel. And the Passover was really one of the first ways that he chose to do that in painting that picture. And on that night, God said, you will take a lamb and you will cut its throat and you will collect its blood. And you will take its blood and you will paint it on the top of the door and on the side posts of the door. And he said, and judgment's coming through the land. See, Egypt, I've said this many times, is a type of the world. Pharaoh, their king, was a type of the enemy. God's people, Israel, is a type of the believer. And God's people were in bondage to the world system and the king of that time. God's people today are in bondage to the world system and the king of this world, the prince of this world, Jesus called him Satan, and that he wants to hold God's people in bondage. But God said, you let my people go so that they might worship. worship me. God wants his people to be set free so that they might be able to worship him in freedom and in liberty. Amen. And so the way that he chose to set them free was through the shedding of blood. He said, you take that lamb, and it's an innocent lamb. We talked about the innocent lamb last week. And you cut its throat, and you collect its blood, and you paint the doorpost, and whenever judgment comes through the land, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. It's not that you're not guilty, Israel. It's not that you're not guilty, Christian. The reason that God's judgment passes over his people is because the judgment was placed upon the Lamb. God's judgment, God is a righteous God. And God has been sinned against in Adam and also through each and every one of us. And so it's not like God just sweeping it under the rug. No, instead, God has a plan where judgment is placed upon the Lamb. So the Passover was to be remembered every year. Now you can about imagine that's like the day that you got saved. Yeah. Yeah, amen. And you know what they would do though is that they would remember it every single year. But with the beginning of the Passover, every year that they remembered it, it would start a week-long festival called Unleavened Bread. Unleavened, leaven is yeast. Yeast is representative of sin if you read it in the New Testament time and again. And they weren't allowed to have any yeast or leaven in their home. And the idea was that you got to get all that stuff out of the house. Amen? And so spiritually speaking, God's designed for us to let the Holy Spirit do a work in our hearts and clean us out. Amen? And so that was the first feast that they had to go to. And then the first Sunday is what we would call it after the Passover was the Feast of First Fruits. And then from there, 50 weeks after that was Pentecost. That's why it's called the Feast of Weeks. 50 days, I'm sorry, I said 50 weeks. 50 days after, but it's the counting the weeks afterwards, it's called the Feast of Weeks. And then also the Feast of Tabernacles. They had to live in a little hut. Why am I saying all that? I'm just trying to remind you what these feasts represent. The Feast of Weeks is the day that the Holy Spirit descended in the upper room on Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descended and the disciples began to speak with other tongues, and the church was born upon that day. Amen. And it has to do with harvest. That's what the Feast of Weeks had to do with. It had to do with the harvest of the grain that they were doing. And whenever the Holy Spirit descended in the upper room on that day and people were filled with the Holy Spirit, it had to do with the harvest. Well, what you talking about, preacher? It had to do with the harvest of humanity. God's working a harvest. He said, look, the fields are white. In other words, it's ready to be plucked. But he said, the laborers are few. Pray, therefore, that there would be laborers. Amen. God's desiring for his people that are called by his name to believe in his word, to believe in his will, and to partner with him. Amen. In this great harvest that's coming so that others might have the opportunity to become part of the family of God. And so that's what the Pentecost was all about. It was in the Old Testament, was about the harvest of grain. In the New Testament, it's about the harvest of souls. Amen. God's not wasting anything. I'm telling you right now, he's a master literary writer. I mean, if you can just see what he's doing, he's proven himself time and again to humanity, but they won't even take the time to read. And then the Feast of Tabernacles was to remind them. Every year they had to do that. They had to build. It didn't matter how nice of a house they lived in. They had to get some sticks and they had to build themselves a little tent and they had to live in that tent for a week. And it reminded them that when they were on their journey in the wilderness, that the God that they served took care of them. And one day, God's coming back to live upon this earth. His presence is going to dwell with his people. Amen. And no more will there be a wandering. No more, like in our song, will there be a pilgrimage where people literally go to Jerusalem to see the Lord. Amen. In their glorified bodies. That's what the Word of God teaches. But the pilgrimage will be different. It won't be on a fallen earth. It won't be full of valleys. It won't be full of dangers. Because the Spirit of the Lord will rule in the atmosphere. Amen. And the presence of God will be there to console. And things will be so much different than anything that we've ever experienced from the time that we've been born upon this earth. But in this psalm, that's what they would sing this psalm to remind them as they would journey to Jerusalem for these three feasts. That's why I brought all of that up. And so as they're journeying physically, they would be in valleys and they would find themselves in the valley. And you know, there was dangers Whether it be during the heat of the day, whether it be the cold of the night, whether it be wild animals, whether it be robbers. A while back we preached on the Good Samaritan and how robbers would lie in wait in the rocky crags. And you never knew what kind of dangers were lurking around and what could possibly overtake you. And so the psalmist would write this psalm, and the people of God, as they would travel, even when they were in the valleys, would say, you know what, I look to the hills. I look up. Amen. So when you're a valley, you got to remember, you need to look up. Amen. And one of the things that I want to remind you, according to verse 2, he says, this is where his help comes from. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Amen. So a lot of people have speculated about the concept of the hills. The psalmist isn't saying that the hills is where his help comes from. And we're not going to get into all the things that happened on hills back in the time of Israel. We've talked about that before. But what I will say is this. I want to remind you something. Jerusalem sat upon a hill. Jerusalem sat upon a hill, and there's actually a scripture out of Matthew chapter 5. And in that scripture in Matthew chapter 5, it talks about the fact that you are the salt of the earth and that you are the light of the world. See, Jesus, when he came into the midst of darkness, he was the light of God that came into the midst of a darkened world. Amen. But what he taught was that whenever you learn to believe in him, there's a transference that takes place. Amen? Amen. He took your guilt like that Passover lamb, and when you put your faith in that, he now took your guilt upon him, and he gave you his righteousness. And through that exchange, his light also went in on the inside of you. Amen. Now, you're the light of the world. He said, you don't light a candle and hide it with a bushel. He said, a city on a hill can't be hidden. Because when you're in the midst of a valley and you're traveling and it's dark and it's cold outside and you don't really know where to go, it's a welcome feeling when you can look up on a hill and you see a lighted hill, because you know that's where the city is and we don't have that much further to go. What I'm trying to tell you though is this, is that for the believer who's in a valley, I'm telling you right now, you and I ought to know that when we're in the midst of a spiritual valley, the only place that we have to look is to look up and to know that our help comes from the Lord and that he's the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what you go through. It doesn't matter whether it's spiritual, physical, emotional. You need to know that the God that you serve, oh, thank you, Jesus, scattered the stars in the sky and breathed life into a lump of clay, and there's nothing that he cannot do for you. I don't care how bad it seems. Lift up your eyes, pilgrim. Amen. Lift up your eyes. To God, oh, I'm preaching to the preacher. Come on, preacher, lift up your eyes. Quit looking down. You're not going to find anything down there. Lift up your eyes and look to the Lord, because that's where your help comes from. Hallelujah. He's the maker of heaven and earth. And if you look to him, he'll put some joy in your heart. Amen. He'll put some pep in your step. Amen. It'll feel good on a brisk, cold morning. Praise God. It'll be a reason to get up and go to church, not to lay up in the bed under warm covers. Not because you're doing it for rules. Don't let me get ahead of myself. All right. Lift up your eyes, pilgrim. But this is the thing. See, you and I ought to know where to put our eyes because we're the people of God. Don't get me wrong. Now, we got to be reminded. I'm not picking on nobody because the preacher, as a matter of fact, if you got my phone number, you want to send me a text every now and then to remind me to lift your eyes up, preacher, I won't get offended, I can promise you. Because we all have a tendency to want to put our eyes back down. When things don't go our way, right? Come on, somebody. You know I'm telling you the truth. When things aren't going our way, we want to let our circumstances and our environment dictate where we put our eyes. No. The Lord said, put your eyes on me. Hallelujah, I'll get you through this thing. Now, the problem is that the world, they don't know. They don't know. And one of the things is this, is that he said in that Matthew 5 passage, he said, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. He said, you're the light of the world. And what I want to tell you is this, is that while we may know, God wants other people to know.
Amen.
Just the other day, I was in the clinic. Two things happened back to back. I was in room 2, and it ended up a conversation happened, and I went across the hallway, and another conversation happened. I don't know how long it's been since that kind of thing has happened. But all of a sudden, you remember Wednesday night when I told y'all something about Mardi Gras? I picked on Mardi Gras a little bit. And I said, and I tried to make the point that there's a difference. But if you went to the Mardi Gras parade and you plan on going, that's between you and Jesus. I'm not over here trying to tell you what to do and what not to do. But don't get offended by me whenever I tell you that Mardi Gras is the worship of the Greek god Bacchus, the god of wine and revelry. And that all you got to do, and anyway, this is what happened. I told y'all that I used to be kind of shy, or I don't know if I was shy, but intimidated whenever people would say, hey, you're going trick-or-treating or you're going Mardi Gras? And I'd be like, I didn't know what to say. And now I'm just like, dude, did you do that? Because you just opened up a door for me. And that's what this old boy did on Thursday. I guess it was Thursday or Friday.
Come on.
He said, you going Mardi Gras, man? I said, you know what? I said, I don't Mardi Gras no more, dude. I said, I used to Mardi Gras, bro. I used to Mardi Gras with the best of them. I said, but you know what, man? I gave my heart to Jesus. Jesus changed me, bro. And I said, you know, I started doing some reading. I said, first off, he said, oh, man, I love the Lord. That's what he said. I said, oh, good. So can we talk about this for a second? He said, yeah, well, sure, man. I want to talk about it. I said, good. I said, first off, from a logical perspective, something started bothering me. Like, I mean, I'm just talking about just thinking real simple stuff. You understand what I'm getting? Like all you got to do, I'll tell you what, I encourage you. If you were planning on going to a Mardi Gras parade, okay, then I want to encourage you, go ahead and go. No, really. Let's do a little scientific test. I'm not telling you to go to the Mardi Gras parade. If you're already convinced that you weren't going to go, then don't go. Amen. Don't go just because the preacher told you to go. Well, and I tried this with my daughter. I'm just going to use you as an example. I tried this with my daughter when she was 8 or 9 years old. And guess what? When she came home, I said, you're not old enough to make decisions anymore for yourself. You won't be going back to any more parades as long as you're a child living in my house. Because I told my kids, I raised you in the ways of God. And you know what? You want to go to a Mardi Gras parade because you say, oh, my friend's family doesn't do this. My friend's family doesn't do that. I'm like, fine. I've taught you about the ways of God. I've taught you about the ways that the people of God are supposed to behave themselves. Doesn't mean that we get it all right, but we know what the Word of God says. Amen. And so you go on out there and you experience and you check out what everybody's doing. I don't care what your little family, friends, family's doing. You check out what everybody out there is doing. You come back and you report to me and you tell me that looks like the church to you. And so when they say, oh, I didn't see nothing wrong with it, Dad. Okay, well, you're not old enough to make those decisions anymore. Now, for you, I'm saying that that's what you plan on doing. Fine, then go. I'm not your daddy and I'm not the Holy Ghost. So I'm not here the one to tell you what to do and what not to do. But when you go, I'm asking you to do what I did one time. The first thing I did was, logically speaking, I backed up for a second. And I just observed.
Amen.
I just observed what everybody was doing. That's all. Not spiritual, just observation. And I thought to myself, this ain't Jesus.
Amen.
It wasn't real hard for me to figure out, this is not Jesus. What they're doing out there isn't Jesus. No, this is pagan worldliness. So that's the first thing I told the old boy. Then the second thing was, I kind of broke down the whole little Bacchus thing, whatever. But then I started focusing on Jesus. I said, dude, he changed me. I don't know what else to say other than he changed me. And I don't really even know what all I said, but all of a sudden, out of nowhere, dude's tears just started streaming down his face. And it was kind of like a little, I didn't expect that. And he said, dude, he said, this was meant to be. He said, man, I took an overdose about 3 weeks ago. He's got this beautiful little baby right there. He said, I took an overdose about 3 weeks ago because I believe God. I love God. But I don't know, I just got so many things going on. I don't know how to find God. And so here's somebody that's in the midst of a valley, is my point. And the fact of the matter is what I'm trying to say is this, is that multitudes, see, according to Joel chapter 3, there's multitudes in the valley of decision. Now, the valley of decision in that passage of scripture is the valley of Jehoshaphat, which is the place where Armageddon is going to take place. What that means is that they already made their decision. You understand what I'm saying? In Armageddon is judgment time. But today is when people are making their decisions. And they're in the midst of the valley of decision. Amen. Multitudes. Amen. They don't know which way to go. And here's Pilgrim on his journey. Amen. And even though he's in the valley, he's supposed to keep his eyes lifted upon the Lord, and he's supposed to allow the light of God that's been transferred to him and that resonates in him to come out of him to let others know, hey, even though you're in the midst of a valley, I got good news. I got to tell you that God is real. Amen. He wants to have a relationship with you. And even though you might be on a valley, in a valley, it might be treacherous. treacherous terrain. It might be, I don't know what you're going through, but God is the creator of heaven and earth, and he can get you through this thing. You just need to learn to trust him also. You need to give your heart to Christ. And then you need to let him do a work in you. Amen. Sometimes it's just about you and I planting seeds in people's lives.
Amen.
Praise God. Can I tell you how many seeds have to be planted sometimes in somebody's life before they actually give their life to Jesus?
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Can anybody agree with me on that?
Yeah.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.
I can remember the first time my sister showed up in my house. I'll tell you all about that when I was 13, and she started talking Jesus. That was the first time that I I had a friend before that. No, she was the first time. Started talking about Jesus. I had never heard nobody talk about Jesus like that. Then the next thing you know, some dude shows up at school out of nowhere. He was an orphan. Lived in a foster home. And he was like, we were in like 7th or 8th grade, and he was like all bowed up. I hate to admit this, but some some kid got sassy mouthed with him, you know. Talked trash to him that everybody else at the school was scared of. And that little orphan guy just beat the snot out of him. And I was like, man, look at this dude, bro. Where did he come from? So I wanted to be his friend. So I started hanging out with this kid. He's like, yeah, man, you want to come over to my foster parents' house? Well, guess what? Lo and behold, they were Jesus freaks.
Wow.
And what I'm trying to say is this, is that every time I turned around, there was somebody talking about Jesus. I can remember, like, I was still rejecting the gospel, still not doing what I was supposed to do, on the strip in Lafayette, going from bar to bar to bar to bar, and here come these college kids. And I can remember about three of my friends walking in front of me, and they're trying to hand them some tracts. And my friends are like, man, I don't want that, I don't want that. And then whenever they got to me, they're like, what about you, dude? You're going to reject him too? And the Holy Spirit is just like dealing with me. All this time, my sister's been talking to me about Jesus and all these other things that have happened. I'm like, man, give me that thing. I just shoved it in my back pocket. And then the next morning when I woke up, I just put the same jeans on. I was ready to go do it again. You know, there's a proverb that talks about that. You know, you're drinking all night long, and then you wake up and you say, oh, let me go do it again. And that's what the proverb. And that's what it was. Time after time, the same old results, same old life, and that's what I did. And I felt back there, and all of a sudden, I pulled that piece of paper out of my pocket. I was like, oh, man, yeah, I think I remember that. And it was a picture. It was drawn in Jesus, and he just had blood streaming down his face. And all it said on the front was, all this I did for thee. And I remember opening it up, and I sat there on the foot of my bed, and I read that whole thing about how it talked about Jesus coming and Jesus dying on the cross for me and setting me free. I'm just trying to make a point. That was just another seed. How many times was I arrested? How many times was I in rehab? How many times was I in detention home? I hate to admit to you that's who I was, but that's who I was. And every single time, it never failed. Come knocking on the door. Hey, we're here to talk about Jesus and seeds being planted. So I want to encourage you that when you're on your journey, you need to remember, amen, that God wants to use you. And you may not have a personality like me. And you might not have scripture memorized. You don't need scripture memorized. If God is changing you and he's going to work in you, then you just share with somebody the level where you are right now. And you let them know, all I know is this. I was looking for something. I found myself in a valley and I decided to look up. Amen. And the next thing you know, he started doing a work in my life. People need hope. Amen. So I just wanted you to know that he is, your help comes from the Lord, from the Lord. Amen. And he is the creator of heaven and earth. And so you and I ought to know that, but there's people out there that don't know it. Verse 3, he will not suffer your foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Let's go ahead and read verse 4 too. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither sleep, shall neither slumber nor sleep. Now, one of the things, this morning I counted this up. That word keepeth, right there, I mean, if you could just follow with me real quick. It says in verse 3, keepeth, in verse 4, keepeth, in verse 5, keeper, in verse 7, preserve, in verse 7, preserve again, in verse 8, preserve. I think that's 6 times, keepeth, keeper, and preserve. It's all the same word in the Hebrew. And it means to build a hedge of protection around or to be a watchman over.
Wow.
6 different times, God wants you and I to know that certainly has to be the emphatic point of this psalm, that no matter what you're going through, God is watching over you. Amen. He's building a hedge of protection around you. He's the watchman of your soul. Amen. And so it says right there that he that keepeth, he will not slumber and he will not allow your foot to be moved. Now, physically, in the sense of if you're walking in a valley or you're walking on a mountainside, the fact of the matter is that you could be walking upon a precipice. I've been on some pretty high places. I remember one time we went on one little hiking trip, and I tell the story all the time. She says I'm over dramatic, but she didn't have her glasses on, and she jumped from one level to another level. And I'm like, what are you doing, dude? It's like 5 feet, and then from there, it looks like hundreds of feet of a drop in the water. She's like, oh, Dad, you're stressing about nothing. I'm like, don't ever do that again. Anyway, you could slip. And if you slip right there, it's not a big deal right here, but over there, you come to your destruction. So the idea here is not that you will never have a slip. The idea is that you will never go backwards. Unfortunately, we should never want to go backwards. We should always want to be moving forward. Amen. But the fact is that sometimes we find ourselves making mistakes on this Christian journey. The idea that it's talking about is that the God that you serve will preserve you. He will keep you. And if you desire to live for him and you keep your faith in what he's offered, which is his son Jesus dying on the cross, and you understand, Daddy, I'm dependent upon you. I'm dependent upon your grace, your strength, your power, because in my own strength, I can't get it done. And if you will keep your faith in him, I'm here to tell you, he won't let your foot be moved. He won't let you fall to your destruction. He will hold on to you and he will get you through this thing. And along the way, he's going to teach you maturity. And along the way, he's going to grow you up in the ways of God. But also got good news for you. He doesn't sleep or slumber. Amen. I don't know about you, but sometimes I get exhausted. Sometimes I get exhausted, man. I get exhausted in life. Not just because I'm doing too much. People say, well, yeah, dude, you got a full-time job. And you're over here. No, it's bigger than that. Sometimes it's emotional things that I'm going through. Sometimes it's just the trials of life. Come on. And I keep on looking up and I'm like, Lord, I know you're the one that's going to get me through this. These are temporary circumstances on a temporary earth. And one day I'm going to see you. Hallelujah. And I long for that day. But in the meantime, sometimes I get exhausted. Sometimes I get exhausted and I go to sleep. I wish that I always slept like I should, but you get my point. Sometimes I get exhausted and I go, but you don't have nothing to worry about. The God you serve, the God of Israel, he never sleeps. Hallelujah. Yeah. He never slumbers. You might get weak, but I got good news for you. He doesn't get weak. Amen. The scripture says, if you want to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I want to just read a quick passage of scripture that was referring, that has something to do with the Apostle Paul. You know, we aren't really ever told exactly what this is that Paul is talking about. I have my own personal opinion, but that's just an opinion. And I mean, it's based upon, studying, but it doesn't make me right. And I'm going to tell you that because I don't want you to think that I feel like I know everything, because I don't. But in this passage of scripture, Paul, his heart is that he's crying out. Something's bothering him. He calls it this thorn in his flesh. Scholars call it the thorn in the flesh. Anybody that's read the Bible is familiar with the terminology of the thorn, Paul's thorn in his flesh. You can tell by the way that he just describes that there's some anguish connected to this situation. Like he's not happy with it. And once again, some people have said it was pride. Some people said it was a physical ailment having to do with his eyes. I personally believe that it had to do with those men that we call the Judaizers. Now, if you've been with us as we've read or taught any of Paul's letters, the Judaizers were, I don't know that it's really that important for the story, but I'm just going to explain it to you in case you were interested. The Judaizers were those men who called themselves brethren. And maybe they did love God, but at the same time, they said that they were saved, but they were teaching the Gentile church that Paul had established, like in Galatia and in other churches like Colossae, that they had to also be circumcised and to observe the law in order to really be holy. And this was getting back, and it was causing confusion in these people's lives because Paul had preached Jesus Christ and him crucified. And now they were trying to add to their faith in Christ. And it was causing a struggle in their walk because when you add something other than Jesus, whatever it is, I've always, my favorite things to pick on have been things like AA and the program and religious works like reading more and praying more and all of that kind of stuff like that. Why? Because those are the things that I struggle with. And when I say AA, if you're in a program, I don't mean that you quit the program, especially if it's court ordered, you got to finish that. Come on, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm trying to say is if you look to another source as your strength, other than Jesus and what he did for you at the cross, which faith in that gives you access to grace, which empowers you. If you're looking to something else to give you strength and you're looking to man's ways, I'm just trying to tell you what the Bible would teach you. You're looking to man's ways and the foolishness of man's wisdom, and which is demonic and sensual. Is it okay if I didn't plan all this, but let me just say this, and I've said it before. Is it okay to say this, that Sigmund Freud snorted cocaine and that he committed incest with his daughter Anna, and that he's the father of psychology, and that it's through psychology that we gain all of this supposed wisdom? I can go on and tell you other developmental psychologists. B.F. Skinner raised his daughter basically in a box where he observed all of her behavior. We could go on and on about, and it's not to say that they've never come up with anything that's interesting or that Kate never was never helpful. But whenever you start to look to the ways of the world and the ways of man's wisdom in order to remedy your malady, now you've put your faith in another source as your strength in order to lift you up and to build you up rather than hoping and trusting in the plan of God. Amen? And when you do that, it's contrary to the ways of God, and now it causes a frustration to the grace of God. You need grace flowing in your life, strengthening you by the power of the Holy Spirit in order to get you through this thing. I don't know about you, but I don't just want to be rehabilitated.
Yeah.
I sat in an AA meeting after I got in all my trouble. I've told y'all stories about that before, and I had to go into this thing called the Recovering Nurse Program, and I had to, call them my color every day, and I had to go to AA meetings at least twice a week. And I can remember, sitting in one of these AA meetings, and this guy walked in there in a nice looking suit, an older gentleman. He's probably a professional. I don't know what he did, because we're all hush hush on all that. But he didn't believe in God. He's sober 35 years. And he tried to convince me that he was happy. I ain't buying it. Amen. Oh, just to hear the pitter-patter of little feet in the house. And, 35 years. And, my God is the fact that I'm, still sober after all this time. But my name is such and such, and I'm an alcoholic and always will be. Well, you can hold on to that label all you want to, sir, but my Bible teaches me something different.
Amen.
My Bible teaches me that I'm a new creation in Christ. That the old man born of Adam died, that he was buried in Christ, and that a new man has resurrected to newness of life. Now, what I will tell you is this. I don't feel like falling down on the ground. I'm sore this morning. But what I will tell you is this. That the old man, he's dead. The old man is dead. But he's got his eye just a little bit open. He ain't leaning down like this. He's dead. But he's got his eye just a little bit open. And he's looking around for something that he can just take a little nibble off of. And I can tell you that if you allow your old man to take a nibble on something, you will be surprised at how fast he will desire to come back to life. That in and of itself don't make AA right, that you always got to be an alcoholic. No, that in and of itself just proves what God is trying to tell us, that in this temporary world, on this fallen earth, even though we find ourselves in valleys, even though that relationship with the sinful nature is supposed to be dead, learning that in Revelation 7, that the fact is that until we see the Lord, Hallelujah. Then guess what? It has not been eradicated. The sinful nature has not been removed out of us. And if you allow that same old trigger to keep on hitting you that it always hits you in the past, what's going to happen is that it's going to come alive and it's going to rule and reign, and you're going to become a slave to it again, and you're not going to be able to get the freedom that you desire to get. I don't know how I got off on all that other than to say this, that the God you serve doesn't slumber, he doesn't sleep. The Apostle Paul was dealing with Judaizers, and the Judaizers were over there telling them, you need to circumcise yourself and you need to observe some of the law, and it'll make you more holy. And what I'm trying to tell you is that today, what the modern church would try to tell you is, it's about what you do and not as much about what Jesus did. And they will formulate a program and they will mix it with psychology and they will tell you, you go this way, whatever the case, and they're not giving you the real Jesus.
Amen.
And you buy into that, and you will find that the power of sin will regain power in your life.
Amen.
Back in that valley.
Yes, back in the valley. And so that's what I believe that Paul was dealing with, these Judaizers coming behind him. Could you imagine that? Here you are preaching at a church. Oh, man, I'm telling you, I've already felt some of this. Here you are preaching what you believe to be the truth of the gospel. And don't say, aha, that's what you said, what you believe to be the truth of the gospel. Listen, you're over here preaching the truth of the gospel, and then people coming behind you and saying things that are contrary to the truth, and it's causing confusion in the people's minds. Paul called it a thorn in his flesh. That's what I believe it was. This is what he says, verse 7. Lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. In other words, he's saying, God gave me so much revelation about the gospel that he knew that there was a tendency that I could become prideful. I could become prideful and I could become exalted in my own mind. So he says, so that I'm not being exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Sometimes God will give you a thorn in the flesh because he knows you better than you know yourself. Amen. And he knows, I've got to give you something right here like this because I love you enough, because I got to hold you down. Amen. He says, a messenger of Satan to buffet me or come against me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing, I besought the Lord thrice that it might depart from me. Now, if you can see the mighty Apostle Paul, thrice means three. Whatever this thing was, he said, I sought the Lord three different times that it might be departed. Lord, I don't want this thorn in the flesh. This thorn in my flesh is uncomfortable. It's painful. I want you to remove it. Amen. Remember, right now what we're talking about is the God of Israel doesn't sleep. He doesn't slumber. Sometimes you get tired. Sometimes you get exhausted. But I got good news for you. The God that you serve doesn't get exhausted. I don't want to lose you in all my little rabbit trails. Amen. When the Apostle Paul says three different times, I sought the Lord to remove this thing, but this is what God's response was. And he said unto me, verse 9, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Hallelujah. You see, that's the main point that I wanted to make to you, is that whenever you feel like you can't go on, when you find yourself in the midst of the valley situation, and you find yourself exhausted to the point where you really feel like you're going to give up, I got to tell you something, that it's at that moment in time that if you will hold on to the Lord, that that's when his power and his strength really begins to show up, because you've gotten to the point where everything that you've tried, everything that you've held on to, everything that you tried to figure out in your own wisdom and your own scheming and all of the things that you wanted to do, it's all come to the end and you've gotten to the point of surrender and you said, Lord, three times I'm begging you to remove this thing, and the Lord's answer is no. Hold on. My grace is sufficient for you. You're going to stay in this until I deem it that it's time for this thing to be removed from you. And what you need to understand is my grace is sufficient for you. And this is another thing you need to know. In weakness, my strength, God's strength, Amen. Is made perfect. Hallelujah. Amen. It's when we come to the end of ourselves that God's strength shows up.
Amen.
I can't tell you how many times I tried and cried out to God, Lord, please do a work on the inside of my heart. I just remember that one morning when I woke up and I said, God, I can't do it. I can't do it. And if you don't get it, if you don't do it, it ain't gonna get done. Amen. And it's almost like when I said that from a broken heart, mm-hmm. God had been waiting 12 years. That's what I felt like the Lord showed me. 12 years I've been waiting to hear that. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I've been stubborn, hard-headed, going to just do my own thing.
Amen.
And God's like, wait, I'm just waiting for you to agree with me, son. That's all I'm doing. It's not that I don't love you. Sometimes you think I'm distant. Sometimes you might think I'm asleep. But the reality of it is that I never sleep and I never slumber. The reality of it, I'm just waiting for you to agree with me. And when you can line up in agreement with me, guess what? I'm about to go to war for you, son.
Amen.
I'm about to go to war for you. I'm about to show up in your life. I'm about to turn some things around. But it's not on your timing. It's on my timing. And you're going to serve me. Hallelujah. My grace is sufficient for you. And so then the Apostle Paul does something that I don't think I'm there yet. I know I'm not. In the next sentence in verse 9, he says this: most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Then he says in verse 10, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong.
Mm-hmm.
He's arrived at a level that I haven't gotten there yet. But I do remember this passage whenever I find myself going through things, when I find myself in a valley. I try to remember that the Apostle Paul had a revelation of it, amen? And that he said, you know what, even whenever I'm in the midst of it, when I'm going through it, he says, I embrace it. I take pleasure in it because I understand that it's working something in me, that even when I'm weak, whenever I'm feeling beaten and downtrodden, God is going to perform something. His power, his strength is going to be manifest in my life because now I'm having to be moved out of the way. But how long does it take for God to break a man? How long does it take for God to cause a man's pride to be moved out of the way enough to where he will surrender and where he would just trust in God? I don't know. Each and every one of us are different, but I know that sometimes that process can be painful. Amen. All right, we're still in Psalm 121, and I just wanted to encourage you with the fact that the God that you serve, he doesn't sleep or slumber. Amen. And that he will keep your foot to where you do not slip to your destruction. Verse 5, the Lord is thy keeper. There it is again. He's your watchman. The Lord is your shade upon your right hand. Verse 6, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. So here we have the right hand. The right hand in the Bible always talks about strength. And what it's talking about right here is it's talking about the believer's strength. See, God wants to give you strength. And at the same time, he says the word shade is descriptive of protection. God wants to protect the strength that he's given you. He doesn't want your enemy to be able to steal it from you. Amen. He wants to protect it. He wants to give it to you. And he wants to protect it as you continue to walk through the journey that you're facing. Amen. In the midst of this life. Then he goes on to say, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. Now, I can tell you that I believe with all my heart that this can have at least two different meanings. And number one, literally, the sun during the day while they were on their travels could cause heat stroke. It could cause danger in that sense. The moon, nighttime, sudden drop in temperature, especially in the mountains, cold air, various dangers that are taking place. That descriptive of our environment, our circumstances that surround us in life. You know, you never know what you're going through. You never know what you're going to face. I mean, think about it. Sometimes things can be going perfectly fine, and the next thing you know, you got a mess on your hands. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, it doesn't take much to cause a mess to take place. I don't know about how many times that I have seen God intervene in the midst of my life and avert tragic circumstances. Man, one time this is just one kind of example. There's a whole lot more that we could use. But one time I was driving back. I drive to home every day for work. And one day I was driving back and all of a sudden an 18-wheeler tire just flew off of the trailer, bounced across the road, and literally bounced right in front of my windshield by about a millisecond, and just bounced off into the ditch, off to the side. I'm just like, dude, if I'm like one millisecond sooner on the road, that thing comes into the windshield, and I'm messed up. You understand what I'm saying? But the God that we serve, he foresees all of these things, and if he's not ready to take Matt, then it's not time for Matt to go, amen? And I just want you to know that there's things that are going on in your environment and in your circumstances that you don't have any control over.
Amen.
Some things you and I have created for ourselves, but some things we haven't. And things that could possibly come against you, God's got your back.
Yeah.
And you're going to find out that even whenever you're trying to walk right with people, that sometimes people just aren't going to like you, and they're going to come against you.
Yes.
And you know what? You're going to have to learn how to just love them through it.
Yeah.
There's some people that are never going to let you forget where you used to be.
Mm-hmm.
Can I tell you that?
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I know, because I've talked to some of them. And all they want to do is focus on your past.
Mm-hmm.
And all they want to do is focus. If people that really knew me from the past, that's all they want to do. It don't matter, like 17, 18 years ago, it don't matter. All they want to do is focus on the past. And you're never going to convince them. What you're going to have to do is you're going to have to live for the Lord.
Amen.
You're just going to have to live for the Lord, let God do the work that He's going to do in you. And guess what God's doing? He's healing your life. He's fixing your life.
Amen.
And the sad thing is that some of them, their life may not be in a mess. The ones that their life isn't a mess, per se, and they see your life being changed, then they're going to probably want what you got. The other ones that think that they got it all figured out, the problem with that is that they may never come to the true Jesus. The reason I say that is that Jesus told, He said this in one of His parables. He said that the well don't need a physician. He was talking about the Pharisees. The Pharisees were some of the sickest people that were around. Why? Because they were full of religious pride. And they thought that they had everything figured out. Jesus wasn't saying, you Pharisees don't need me. Jesus was saying, you think you're well. You think you don't need me. So I guess I didn't come for you. In reality, who I came for was the sick. Those that know that they need me. Amen. If you can't change their mindset, because I'm trying to tell you that I've tried to change these people's mindset. Whether they were talking about you or whether they were talking about me. I've tried to change their mindset. I've tried to have conversations with some of them. Hour long or more. Trying to talk to them about the Bible. And the reality of it is that half the time that, oh, well, I don't believe everything the Bible says. Well, there's your problem, hoss. You're over here trying to pick and choose the parts of the scripture that you want to believe. God either wrote it or He didn't. And if He wrote it, then you're going to have to submit to it. And if you're unwilling to submit to it, then you're not going to believe that the God I serve can take somebody out of a valley and put them on top of a hill, fill them up with His Holy Spirit, and give them the strength that they need in order to walk right and to live right. The God that I serve, I know that He can do that. I know that He can change human lives. I'm not backing up. And even if somebody falls tomorrow, even if the preacher falls, it don't mean that God can't do what God said He could do. Amen. It doesn't mean that the grace of God doesn't work. It doesn't mean that the Word of God doesn't work. God is real, and He's a changer of the human heart. Amen. That's the Word of God right there. But not only that, not only will He protect you from the surrounding circumstances and people trying to come against you and things trying to come against you, but you know, in the book of Genesis chapter 1, God gave the sun and the moon for days and for seasons, for months. You know, you're going to go through different seasons in your life. Sometimes, look, I've seen this before. Sometimes when things are going good, I'm just being real with you, okay? Sometimes when things are going good in people's lives, man, I'm telling you, they in church. They got some pep in their step, and they ready to come to church. Sometimes it's, for other people, it's when things are going bad in their lives. They want to go to church. And then when you flip-flop the reversal of fortunes for whichever one, the ones that like going to church, when it's good, when it gets bad, oh, I just can't make it. Or whenever the bad ones, when it gets good, oh, man, everything's going good. I don't need Jesus no more. I got this. I'm on autopilot. And I'm never trying to make this to be a rules-based situation, because you know my heart on that. It's not you coming to church that gets you into heaven, right? We've established that in this church. I hope we got that. I mean, I used to go to a church where I know the preacher loved Jesus, but what the preacher said was, if you ain't on church on Wednesday in the rapture after, you ain't gonna make it. Well, hold on a second, I might have got caught talking to somebody about Jesus. You'll never hear me tell you that kind of thing. But what I will say is this, is that, you know, I wondered about this little pilgrimage as these families would travel to Jerusalem to go see the Lord. I would imagine that there were two types of people on that journey too. You know, those that were excited. We're going to get a little bit closer to the presence of the Lord. We're going to be reminded again of the Passover lamb and how God delivered us as a nation out from Egyptian bondage. We're going to see the temple of God. We're going to be able to feel the presence of God a little bit closer. Amen. And then there were those that were just going through duty, going through the motions of going to church. I got to tell you that duty's only going to hold you for so long. You know, I mean, I appreciate people that love coming to the house of God. But if you're just doing it, trying to do it out of duty, it's only going to hold you for so long. Right. There should be a desire, amen, as the family of God and the people of God, that we would be able to come together to feel the presence of God. Man, the music service, I know I could feel the presence of God. Yeah. Sometimes you just got to let yourself go.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, and just not pay attention to whatever it is that's been distracting you. And just listen to the words that are being sung. And focus on the presence of God and let God do a work in your life. Amen? And I just want to encourage you with that. That you never know who's going to show up. I know we have a small church, but Robert will tell you, man, we've been teaching a Bible study for, I don't know, 11, 12 years. I can't tell you the people that have come in and out of that Bible study. I used to get discouraged by it, like, why don't they stay? But I'm not going to stress about that anymore. I'm just going to keep preaching the way God's called me to preach and believe that we've planted some seeds in some people's lives. Yeah. At the same time, you never know who might show up on a Sunday morning that you said, you know what, I don't feel like it. Times are going good or times are going bad. I don't feel like going to church. But then you decided to show up, and it might be somebody from junior high. It might be somebody from high school that you knew, and they were like, oh, man, I didn't know you, you know. And some people, you might say, well, yeah, well, I would prefer not to see some of them people. And I get that. That happened to me whenever I first got saved, and I went to a church in Lafayette. I'm like, oh, my goodness, look at all these people that I know in here. Like, it's a crazy kind of history. But, you know, the fact of the matter is that you don't need to stress about that either. Because if they show up at church, that means that they're searching for something just like you were searching for something. Amen. And all I'm trying to say is that by you being here and by you being willing to talk to them, it just lets them know that there's other people out there looking, amen, and searching, if you're not ashamed of Jesus anyway. Praise God. So you're going to go through different seasons in your life. Sometimes things are going to be good. Sometimes things are going to be bad. But the fact of the matter is that God will get you through, amen, and he wants to be the joy and he wants to be the strength in your heart, amen. It says right here, we're going to close with these last two verses. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. I don't know about you, but there's times in my walk when I've cried out that prayer to God where I've said, Lord, please protect my soul. Amen? Protect my soul, oh Lord. The enemy, I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but sometimes I feel like the enemy is just licking his chops, man, and he's just ready to pounce and to try to destroy and to bring destruction in the midst of my life. And I'm just like, Lord, protect my soul. Amen. Don't allow preserve my soul, oh Lord God. And God wants to preserve your soul. Amen. And let me just say this. God's in covenant with you. I know that we don't talk about this a whole lot, but we've talked about it before. And that the word covenant literally means agreement. And that God made an agreement with mankind. And the agreement was that man was a sinner and that God was holy, but that God sent the Holy One to take man's sin. Amen. And that when you put your faith in that, you're in agreement with him in his covenant. And as you keep your faith in that, you remain in agreement with him in his covenant. And as you continue to walk this journey of life and you say, Lord, I got a lot of growing to do, but I got my faith in you. I got my faith in your son. I thank you for this covenant. Lord, preserve my soul. Amen. God will go to war for you. I just want you to know that. The word says in verse 8, the Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. God's never going to quit on you. You may decide one day that it's not worth it. I'm just going to be honest with you. I remember one time Aaron and I, we went one time to Bourbon Street with that guy Lance Rao carrying the cross. And I can remember this one dude came up to Aaron and he said, Aaron was trying to talk to him about Jesus. And he said, the guy told him, he said, man, I tried Jesus. I tried that stuff. And Aaron told him, you tried Jesus? You think he's some kind of pair of shoes? You try him on, he doesn't fit right. You take him off, you throw him back in the closet. No, you don't try Jesus. You hold on to Jesus. You put your faith in Jesus. Amen. And you don't never let go. He's not something that you try one day and that you throw him to the side the next. And I just want to encourage you with that. That if you will hold on to him, amen, he will preserve your ways. He will watch you as you come. He will watch you as you go. And he will hold on to you.